One of the Carnot agents involved in the viral video incident in Latham has been arrested. The agent in question was reportedly the one who was seen gunbutting the suspect and shooting at his door. Carnot said the officer is currently being held without bail on allegations of assault and discharging a loaded firearm. Well, all I can say is, folks in Guyana have it good. If this were America, the officer would have gotten a paid vacation instead. Ha! On Saturday night, the owner of Matai Supermarket, Harry Matai, was stabbed during an attempted robbery at his house. According to the cops, Matai and his family had just returned home when the suspects approached him on his bridge. They searched him for valuables and a fight ensued, ending with one of the men stabbing him in the lower back before fleeing on a bicycle empty-handed. Matai has since been treated and discharged from the hospital. 36-year-old customs broker Carlisle Watson, aka DJ Raw Gold. His name's Carlisle Watson, what a fancy name. Anyway, DJ Raw Gold faced the magistrate's court for allegedly attacking Marlon Williams, called DJ Yannick, with a broken bottle and for assaulting Melissa Duke. Watson denied the two charges. Nevertheless, the chief magistrate released Watson on $55,000 bail and adjourned the matter until May 3rd. On Sunday night, 29-year-old Tu Shao Orn Fernandez of Chinese Landing Village in Region 1 was boat-jacked. According to Fernandez, he docked his boat near his home on the Barima River and went inside for the evening. But when he woke up bright and early Monday morning, he found out that his boat was gone. According to persons in the area, they saw a man cut the rope and ride off with the young Tu Shao's boat. Yesterday, Mark Royden Williams, also known as Smalley, faced the High Court to answer two murder charges. Smalley is accused of murdering 35-year-old Rajesh Singh and 25-year-old Fazul Hakim during a robbery on December 16, 2007 on the East Coast. He pleaded not guilty to the charges. Nevertheless, he was remanded back to prison until his next court day. Starting off with news of the police arresting a minibus driver after he chased a police officer with a cutlass during a traffic stop in Georgetown on Tuesday. According to the police, the constable stopped the minibus after he saw the driver overtake a line of more than 15 vehicles near Home Stretch Avenue. But this altercation took place on Sheriff Street after a short high-speed chase between the officer and the driver. After the driver sufficiently scared off the cop with his cutlass, he drove home, where he was later arrested, and he is currently being held without bail. Today, 28-year-old Josh Harry, the other viral video minibus driver, made another court appearance for his assault, this time answering to an assault and a damage to property charge. The two charges stem from his verbally assaulting the female passenger and slapping the phone out of her hand after she requested that he lower the volume on the vulgar music he was playing at the time. But frankly, he should have been slapped with another charge of poor taste in music and one for pickish behavior. Aha! Anyway, he pleaded not guilty to the actual charges and was released on $10,000 bail. Harry is expected back in court May 14th. Giving him just enough time to assault another passenger, or maybe even two, before his next court day. Taking a break from private sector crime, we move on to public sector crime. Chief Justice Acting Roxanne George on Tuesday effectively declared the appointment of Sarah Brown and Vikash Ramkissoon as parliamentary secretaries as illegal. According to the Chief Justice, you cannot be both an elected and non-elected parliamentarian at the same time. This means the two will have to be removed from the National Rum Shop, seeing as they were on the list of the candidates for the PPP, but they currently sit as non-voting members following their appointment as parliamentary secretaries. Brown is the parliamentary secretary to the Amerindian Affairs Ministry, while Ramkissoon is the parliamentary secretary to the Agriculture Ministry. I don't know how they managed to mess this up, especially after this whole Cherindas thing, but whatever. Anyway, Chief Justice George said it cannot be accepted that as elected MPs, they have been appointed to the National Assembly as if they were not and without voting rights. The reasoning for the government argument are too long and boring to detail here, so You know, you can just look it up. It's pretty easily out there on the internet. But just know that Nondalor is appealing the High Court's decision. Aran Royalty Incorporated is the name of the import company that is accusing Eye Oil of reneging on an oral agreement to import fuel on their behalf. Since then, Aran Royalty's lawyer said Eye Oil has 48 hours to come clean on the verbal contract and the nature of it, or they will take Eye Oil to court. Well, your boy Noriko decided to do a little digging and found out that Aran Royalty, which is a terrible name for a company, by the way, it's not royalty, and it's not realty, it's royalty. Anyway, Aran Royalty Incorporated was found in 2016 by Dr. Jason Aran, an epidemiologist and 2015 graduate of the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. But after failing to find success as a doctor or in running a medical company or even a nursing home, he decided to start this one, which primarily imports produce into the country and fuel. But as it turns out, Aran is actually no stranger to the court, as he was slapped with over 9 fraud charges in 2018. According to the court, Aran here likes to write bad checks. In almost all the cases, he borrows money, claiming some big government contract is coming through, and when it comes time to repay the loan, he just gives the person a bounce check. But before that, in 2017, he was charged with forgery of a power of attorney contract, meaning he basically abused his powers and took hundreds of thousands of dollars that was entrusted to him to use for his own use. Anyway, Eye Oil has launched an investigation to determine just how a man with so many fraud charges could have even been having engagements with senior officials with the state fuel company in the first place. Nevertheless, he claims he bought around $3 million of fuel and he is expecting someone to pay up for it. So, we will update you as this story continues. Shortly after 2 this morning, 7 juveniles escaped from the Sapphire Holding Center. According to the police, a quick response from guards on duty led to the recapture of 3 of the escapees. Later in the morning, the mother of one of the escapees returned him to the center, while 3 children still remain on the run. Nondalor has just announced that hemp will be grown on the East Bank as early as June of this year. In fact, the government is currently in talks with an American company to get seeds sent down here in bulk. Now, hemp is in fact always been legal in the nation. In fact, Burnham grew it in 4 locations in the 1970s, but fell due to political and economic pressure he felt over the years. And in fact, the ropes and the sails that boats had used throughout the British Empire coming in and out of Port Georgetown were made of hemp. But at some point, I believe in the 1930s or 40s, we just decided to listen to Americans and ban hemp, saying that it's related to marijuana. Well, it is related to marijuana, but it won't get you high. Why did they spread the lie that it will get you high? Well, because they wanted all the oil and chemical companies to sell you their products instead of making your stuff out of hemp. So, good for us, we've got it back. The minibus driver who was caught on camera chasing a police officer with a cutlass was today sentenced to 12 months in prison. Corliss White was slapped with 14 charges, including resisting arrest, disorderly behavior, as well as dangerous driving. He pleaded not guilty to all but one charge. That charge was not wearing a seatbelt. White was released on $240,000 bail and will be back in court May 28th. Although I really, really wish he was getting more than just 1 year, but we will see what the court will really say on the 28th of May. On Wednesday night, 33-year-old delivery driver Navin Mahadal was shot in the jaw by 2 bandits stealing his motorcycle. According to police, the attack occurred at John Street in Campbellville, Georgetown. Mahadal is currently hospitalized and is listed in a critical condition, while the men still remain on the run. Today, 25-year-old Daquan Wills and 39-year-old Joel Fungafat were charged for cocaine possession. They were jointly accused of trafficking over 1 kilo of cocaine. In fact, when they were stopped by Kanu on Tuesday, they fled. And when they drove off, they threw the kilo out of the window somewhere along Vlissingen Road, but the cops quickly located the abandoned drugs and the drug dealers. The 2 were released on $300,000 bail, and their case was adjourned to May 14th. The fifth juvenile to escape the Sapphire Holding Center early yesterday morning has been recaptured. While four were captured soon after, the fifth was recaptured that evening with the help of a relative. Two juveniles remain on the run. Hey, Uncut News viewers, thanks for watching. You can subscribe by clicking on this button over here, or click over there for more news. You can also drop a comment to let me know if you've made it to the end of the video. Goodbye for now!